Good afternoon. I'm Indrajit Gupta. On behalf of our team at Founding Fuel and our partners Boom Live, I'd like to welcome you to this special Facebook Live on the future of technology-enabled commerce in India. E-commerce in India is at the crossroads, and we'll try to make sense of the past and the current reality, but more importantly, see what the future has in store. The debate over whether the Indian e-commerce market can turn from an ugly duckling into a swan depends on which side of the fence you sit. At one end are local e-commerce companies, whether it's Flipkart, Snapdeal and Myntra and the others, are going through a massive restructuring that's left everyone gasping for breath. At the other, the march of global companies like Amazon and the potential entry of the Chinese trio, Baidu, Alibaba and Tencent, seem to suggest there is considerable headroom for growth. Galloping smartphone ownership and the declining cost of data continue to make India one of the world's largest e-commerce opportunities. And disruptive technologies, whether it's big data and analytics, machine learning, and AI, are pushing the frontiers of what is possible. But the reality is that no one has found a sustainable way to do business yet. So the real issue is, can technology and business model innovation change the way Indians shop? Whichever way you look at it, the chances are that the next 5 years may look very different from the last 5 years. And to debate that, we have a stellar panel, the names of that all of you are familiar with. So let me quickly introduce each of them. I'll start with Sanjeev Bikhchandani, Vice Chairman and Founder at InfoEdge, the man best known for building brands like Naukri and for investing in Zomato, among others. He joins us from his office in Greater Noida. Welcome to the show, Sanjeev. Amit Agarwal has led the charge at Amazon India since the time they started in 2013. He's had a distinguished career at Amazon, including a stint as technology advisor to Jeff Bezos, and also led their international expansion. Hi, Amit. Thanks for joining us from Bangalore.
Thank you for having me.
And finally, Haresh Chawla, who's in our studio here in Mumbai. Haresh's writings in Founding Fuel have been amazingly prescient and perceptive. He's an astute investor himself and has worked with many e-commerce entrepreneurs over the years. Welcome, Haresh.
Thank you.
We have three sections planned for this Facebook Live. First, what are the lessons from the e-commerce journey so far? Where we also explore what's changed and why. Second, what are the challenges ahead? Or what will it take to stay relevant? And finally, the third section, where we'll do some crystal ball gazing, what will the next 5 years look like? So during this conversation, we'd also be taking a few questions from the audience. Please share your questions on our Facebook events page on Twitter or on Twitter with the hashtag FFLive. So let's get started. Sanjeev, I'll come to you first. Several billion dollars have been spent to develop the e-commerce market here. Now, here's the moot point. Has the collective burn helped build habit, forced consumers to look beyond price and discounts, and hasten the transition to a loyal, profitable relationship? What do you think?
Oops. It was seeded substantially due to offering very attractive offers. But I do believe online shopping has become a habit.
Okay.
At least for some people. And that number is growing. Now, discounts and attractive prices do drive usage. And I do believe that there are enough customers now who stopped looking at price so much and are more looking at what's available, reliability, convenience, and so on. So, in my case, for example, I go to shop online largely because I find it a smart and easy thing to do. Okay, I don't go into granular price comparisons anymore. I don't look for the best possible deal anymore. I just see, am I getting something I want? Does the price look reasonable? And if it does, then I go ahead with it.
Right. No, that's important that you bring that up, and I'd like to kind of ask bring in Amit here. I know, Amit, that Amazon, you do take a long view, but what does your experience so far suggest? What have you learnt about the Indian consumer and the strong value-seeking nature of our consumer here?
Yeah, I think, when we launched in India in 2013, so it's been a little over 3 years, 3.5 years, you know, we had the viewpoint that customers in India would be no different than our global customers, where they like massive selection and great value, as you pointed out, and fast and reliable delivery. So I would admit that a lot of the customers initially measured their shopping habits based on value. But we have seen the other pillars of selection and convenience play out reasonably fast in India relative to what we had imagined. I mean, if somebody told me the speed at which customers cross-shop on Amazon.in today and the diversity of items that they buy, everything from the mobile phone that they started with to the everyday essentials, I would have been very surprised. And similarly on convenience, the lift that we are seeing with our Prime offering and the attachment that we are seeing in customers shopping with fast and reliable delivery by paying, we are seeing customers are paying for convenience and we are seeing they're shopping a broad set of items. I mean, just to give you a sense, I think people, when they join a Prime free trial, their shopping patterns increase 400%. And once they pay for Prime, that goes up 200% after the free trial. So that's a significant lift that you see. So I think the selection and convenience pillars, in my opinion, would be the long-term sustainable ones that truly differentiate and drive loyalty.
Interesting that you say that, Amit. Have you kind of, because you've dealt with international expansion and seen other markets, do you find any other markets in the Amazon world that in some ways mirror the Indian experience?
See, I think, we do have the benefit of sort of charting out the Indian metrics against the other countries. You know, you can chart out the rate of active customers, the attrition rate, the adoption, the cross-shopping behavior, the lift that you see when every high-value activity happens. You know, what happens when they shop for their first non-CE, non-consumer electronic item, and what happens when they shop in a particular category. India doesn't really shine as something dramatically different. In fact, the pace at which we are seeing the Indian consumer adopt those pillars is very impressive. I think one dimension that is very different and that would pose a lot of invention challenges is the ASP or the selling price of an item in India. So I'm sure we'll get to that. You know, that's kind of one of those elephants in the room that people would talk about. But I think if you look at all the other metrics, the impact of selection, impact of available selection, impact of a seller coming online, impact of customer adopting Prime, the lift that we see, all of those metrics are pointing all in the right direction.
Very interesting that you say that. And I'll come to Harish because, Harish, you've been kind of writing very vigorously about how Indian e-commerce is caught in a bit of a bind where the increased burn isn't necessarily leading to higher growth. And you've argued that it can be construed as a zero-sum game. What's your take?
Yeah, I don't think, as far as you come to the consumer point of view, I don't think there is a consumer challenge at all. I mean, consumers in India, go through shifts, and we've seen that in several categories. So once they shift, it's irreversible. So people will continue buying online. I think, as Amit says, the behavior shift has happened. The habits are playing out. Even, for example, whatever the Prime offering is playing out exactly like it's doing in other markets. The challenge is with the business model, and that I see is a 10 by 10 problem. $10 billion got invested over the last few years in building a e-commerce business whose true revenues are in the range of $10 billion. So if you look at it, the challenge is that amount of money that's going in and it continues to go in, how will it generate return, especially given the fact that Indian consumers, we've kind of probably hit a cliff now. We've saturated the first 70, 80 million people in the country who actually have over half the income and probably a higher chunk of the disposable income in the market. And that is getting exhausted now. It's going to become even tougher as we go along. So even currently, we'll come to the debate about what the average selling price is. But $10 billion spent by 70 million customers yields an average of about $150 per head annual spend. And in China, that number is about 1,800. So I'm not saying we need to become China, but is $150 sustainable? And what's going to happen to that $150 as we hit the next 70 million customers? Let's keep it at that. Let's figure out how to double the the reach of or penetration of this e-commerce space, what's that going to cost us, and what will it do to the balance sheets of the incumbents right now who is playing in the market? I think that those are the big issues I see. Nothing from the consumer, and consumers will lap it up. I think the convenience is playing out. A lot of well-heeled customers are not looking at price anymore. Convenience is a driver, really. But you know, growth and at what cost becomes a challenge.
So, Harish, would you then think that we may have, in some ways, overestimated the size of the market? Because if you last year, when we were looking at some of the early studies done by Morgan Stanley, for instance, which projected the growth of the e-commerce market at $119 billion and about 320 million shoppers by 2020.
Yeah.
More recently, BCG published a report which pegged the size of the market at some 50 million, a billion by 2021, up from about 12 million now. The gap is yawning. So it's a huge yawning gap. So did we get misled by some of that data?
Yeah, I guess some of the analysts, you know, we should all be having what they were having when they wrote these estimates. This doesn't happen in India. You know, while we see look like a $1.2 billion market, look at the way our income is income demographic divide exists, actually. The top 20-30% of India is the spending power of the country. To move beyond that, you have data connectivity issues, you have logistics issues, you have simple affordability issues. So, you know, to call ourselves as a huge market and it'll, you know, we'll have $100 billion in a few years' time is all piece of nonsense that's been fed to a lot of people, and people seem to have acted upon it.
Sanjeev, any comments from you on the market estimates that were
it's been
put
said
up?
Earlier,
yeah.
It's been said earlier as well in the 2000 meltdown, when the first dot-com bubble burst. Can you hear me? Yeah, I can hear you now. Okay, so it's been said earlier that the impact of the internet is overestimated in the short run and underestimated in the long run, right? So people got their short-term estimates wrong in the year 2000. They probably got their short-term estimates wrong right now, maybe a year or two ago. But in the long run, they may have underestimated the impact. It's a question of doing the right things now and staying on till then.
Okay. So I just kind of want to focus one more aspect which comes up whenever we talk about the India opportunity, which is this whole rapid growth in smartphone ownership. And we ran a poll on Twitter in the last couple of days, and I like to kind of pan on that if those results could be put up. But the question that we asked is that, and you can see it on the screen now, is smartphone ownership a good enough proxy for e-commerce growth? And surprisingly, on Twitter, we found 44% actually agreeing that yes, indeed it is. I like Amit for you, and maybe Harish as well, to come in on that, because do you think that there is a good positive correlation between the two?
So I think you know, I would admit that having been at Amazon now for 18 years, the time frame in which we kind of evaluate things tends to make us less focused on short-term predictions and a lot of these indicators, because I think you need to ask yourself in the next 30 years what's going to happen, and what kind of infrastructure step by step do we need to build. Now the intensity of how you go about it might change because of the you know, of the short-term opportunity or the competitive scenario and so on. But I think if you take a very long-term view, and I'm really talking about long-term as in decades, I think the short-term story is driven by smartphone because it makes it accessible. But I think ultimately it's all going to be about people in India wanting massive selection at great prices and convenient delivery at home, fast and reliable delivery. And I think that principle is not going to change. You're not going to have 20 years later the Indian consumers say, give me less selection at a higher price and slow delivery. So I think once you have your head around the most important things like that, you have the patience to think very long term, then there would be ups and downs in the short term. I was at Amazon when the dot-com burst happened, and I was at Amazon when our stock price was the lowest point, and Amazon today is a very different company than what it was. I think it gives you the license to figure out how to invent so that customers don't have to make trade-offs And I agree that there are challenges, but when you take a long-term outlook and we have the patience to invent, I think some of these short-term indicators are just interesting tidbits. The bigger trend for me is Indian consumer becoming like the global consumer, wanting massive selection at great prices and fast delivery.
In fact, Amit, I know you've kind of brought in your global playbook, but as you go about building the India business, you referred to some of the local nuances that you'd have to factor in, ASP being one of them. Were there any other things that came up while you were building the India business over the last three and a half years?
No, I think, you know, having been in a company that really treats frugality as one of its core leadership principles, I think it's a good mindset to have that, you know, talk about low ASP, that, you know, you need to really invest every single rupee into adding value to the customer. You just cannot, especially in India now, you cannot really do that and anything else. I think the power of the Indian entrepreneur was a big learning for me personally. I think we have seen, as we have grown up, that the Indian entrepreneur would have an STD booth and then they have the photocopy shop, and they so easily migrate to learning new skills. We find ourselves depending upon the Indian entrepreneur as a seller, as a brand selling globally, as a logistics provider delivering our items, as a pickup point, as a Udaan center giving access to customers in rural areas. So I think that learning of tapping into that is a good example of an innovation that allows us to take the local cost structures and the global principles of convenience and marry them together to make it work. You know, mobile is an obvious learning. I think we all knew that mobile is important, but to the extent the traffic on mobile access points grew for us, you know, almost 80% of our traffic come from mobile now. I never expected the speed at which that would go. So a lot of the thinking that we do around mobile first, all of these have gone back and helped Amazon globally. So I think that to me is such a huge flywheel effect that we enjoy, that every innovation that we made with the local entrepreneur, we have found a way to use it somewhere else. You know, our Easy Ship software is used now in UK, and our I Have Space pickup point is being used in developed countries. And it's having a bigger impact on the overall Amazon flywheel, even though the Indian business might be much smaller to realize that impact today. The mobile first has allowed us to build so many different things to make our latency better, to improve our customer experience. And I think all of these learnings have been tremendously useful for us globally.
Amit, we'll get into some of those in some detail in our subsequent sections, but I'd like to just close this section with a couple of comments from Harish and Sanjeev. You heard Amit talk about the laser sharp focus that they have on the user and building the business model around it. Did we miss a trick or two as Indian internet entrepreneurs kind of built their own e-commerce businesses? Harish?
Yeah, and I've said this before. I think funding was considered a proxy of success. So somewhere, I think that's been the challenge with a lot of Indian teams, that a lot of money was used up and overestimation of market, overinvestment in inside the company, in building out large teams, and not enough focus on winning in a market where, you know, the margins are going to be thin, you know, competition will take a long-term view. And therefore, that's been the challenge as we're seeing these companies now grapple with layoffs and cut down costs. I think it's a good thing that this has happened at this stage. A lot of companies that will emerge out of this, you know, next few months of a mess will be much stronger and much sharper and leaner, and be in a position to fight global competitors. I don't see the game as being given away or anything like that. It's a question of which company focused on the fundamentals more. It's just simple back to basics. Buy something cheaper, sell it for a higher price, make sure your costs are kept under control. So none of these, it's not a very, in a sense, the complexity is coming from the market, but as business fundamentals go, you know, you have to find a way to scale the business, use the natural momentum that India is providing in terms of mobility, mobile access, and use that to your advantage. Fact is that if Indian consumers are clearly ready to buy more, you know, they've overdone the deals and discounts actually. They could have bought loyalty with that money, but they didn't. They ended up just giving that money away. Some of these things everybody will revisit now. And that's extremely healthy, what's happening now.
Sanjeev, do you agree with what Harish is saying?
Well, I think Indian entrepreneurs are smart. I won't write them off. they'll figure it out, they'll bounce back, many of them. And look, you know, I must comment, you know, I think I must really appreciate the honesty and candor with which Kunal Behel wrote that email to his employees. It's very rare to find a business leader, an entrepreneur, CEO openly admitting to mistakes. First, you know, the first step to solving a problem is to recognize it and accept it as a problem. And I think Kunal has done that. He's taken that important first step.
So we'll quickly with that move on to the second segment, which is really the heart of our conversation today, which is around the challenges ahead. What will it take to stay relevant? And I'll start with you, Amit, and then come to Haresh and Sanjeev as well. It's often been said that it's hard to make money at the kind of low bill values that we have currently in India. And we've got to then focus both on improving frequency and average ticket size so that we can hasten the shift to more profitable growth. I know you spoke to us about your experience with Amazon Prime. What have you kind of learned so far which suggests that there is this shift is imminent or possible?
See, I think, you know, ultimately the business fundamentals, as Haresh pointed out, you have to understand what your cost structure is, what your revenue structure is, and how you're going to make money. That math is not going to change, and you will have to recognize what the constraints are. What I think the mental model that we have is a lot more settled on. You can't let customers make that choice. You know, your customers want great selection at competitive prices and fast and reliable delivery, and then you have to figure out a way to invent so that they don't have to make that trade-offs. What I feel confident about is that with a very long-term horizon and with the license to invent, you will figure that out. You know, some of these things are already playing out. If you just take logistics, for example, how we deliver items in other countries is very different from how we do it in India. We had to figure out the role of the Indian entrepreneur in that ecosystem in a scalable manner that makes it a win-win-win for the customer, for the entrepreneur, and for the Amazon. And that has really helped us gain substantial improvements in that segment. When you look at loyalty, absolutely, you know, we've seen a significant increase in the repeat purchase rates in how customers come to Amazon. The moment we add more selection, each time we add an item that is in stock, or each time we add a more expansive selection, customers shop more on Amazon. I think converting that into making those items travel in the same box would require invention. So those are examples of things that you will have to do. It will take patience. It will take time. It will require investments at the core layers. So your fulfillment infrastructure would be a cost that you will have to ensure you spend ahead of time to have the inventory being in the right place. And you'll have to figure out how consolidation works of shipments. And so those are some of the things that you will have to do. There are many other ideas and things that are already having impact. I don't want to sort of talk about them just because they are things that we are very excited about. But there is no question that India will challenge our ability to invent. And for that, we at Amazon don't feel that we have to do anything different from a customer perspective. We just have to continue to think Indian. For me, I keep showing my team this Shetty restaurant menu. I mean, they have like 350 items. They're all like 55 rupees and so. The guy comes to your table faster than any waiter in any restaurant can come. He doesn't forget any. The defect rate is so low. You get your food and the delivery as fast as you can, and you come out happy. I mean, I think we need to figure out how to build that mental model somehow in this opportunity.
That's a very interesting point that you make, because I think that the story in China is also about understanding the local context. And that local context in India is also fascinating. Haresh, I'll just come to you. Retail, as we've been discussing, whether it's online or offline, is a very low margin business. And how do you kind of then find smart ways to cut out waste and drive efficiencies, especially at the back end and in customer acquisition using technologies? Given what you've seen so far, how would you play the game differently?
I think there are two challenges in India. I mean, there are many more, but at a simplistic level, there is one, there is an MRP on one end of the equation. you know, which determines how much margin and play any player has got. And at the other end, you have a high logistics cost. I think therefore, you know, any e-commerce player will have to just simply wake up every morning and say, how do I become the thinnest layer of cost as a company? That as the company itself, the kind of teams I deploy, the kind of manpower I use, the kind of infrastructure I rent, all that has to be so thinly funded and tightly run. And, you know, you probably have to use one man to solve five problems and put five men as you would do in a normal company. Because the market is not affording that kind of margin structure at all, and it won't. I don't see that changing for a reasonable period of time. At that 1200, 1500 rupee price point, right? That's the average ASP. Half of that is a smartphone actually, which is selling at 5000 rupees. So what's left in a sense of non-smartphone sales online is 700, 800, 900 rupees. And even if you had 20%, 25% of that available to you to play with, that leaves very little money on the table after you've handled returns, logistics, payment charges, storage charges. So therefore, I think the reality is that this is going to be a game, as Amit said, about invention on trying to figure out what are the ways by which you can cleverly utilize every iota of resources you got and the cost structure you have, and tighten that up and find a way to use the leverage that the internet provides you or mobiles provide you to get the scale at which you start making some money. Otherwise, you know, it's a really long path ahead. Even if you say that half of the $10 billion that's been spent so far is evaporated, so we need to get only $5 billion back. To earn that $5 billion, I don't know whether it'll ever happen in the next 5 years also. So I think the game is really tough and tight. I think some of us are realizing it too late, and you're seeing you know, startup after startup, even in vertical e-commerce or even horizontal e-commerce, all coming to this realization that a high cost structure is a recipe for disaster.
Sanjeev, I wanted you to come in, I wanted to address one part of the other challenge, which is on the supply side. Because we do have a very, very fragmented supply chain. We know how the Kirana model operates in India and the cost structures that are almost impossible to compete with. How do you deal with that complexity? Because many of these suppliers are also very thinly capitalized, and most of them are traders. So when you're kind of looking at building up a supply network from an e-commerce perspective, how much of a challenge does that fragmented nature pose? And I'll come to Amit after that, after we hear what you have to say.
I'll make a couple of quick comments. I'm not the expert in e-commerce supply chains, but my impression is that actually we may discover that the Indian offline supply chain is pretty efficient as it is. Okay, so this whole thing of we will make the supply chain efficient, you know, and therefore do e-commerce or we'll do organized retail, you may be up against something which is unanticipated. And why do I say that? It's because at every point in the supply chain, there's an entrepreneur. And a rupee saved for him is a rupee in his pocket. And with that kind of incentive to be efficient, you know, there are not as many opportunities to increase efficiency as there might have been in a developed market. So I think people must be conscious of that. Second, you know, there are horizontal e-commerce players, and then there are vertical e-commerce opportunities. And the strategy and the challenges will be different for each of these. The third point is that, look, this whole assortment function of retail, do you get enough choice when you go to a local store for a certain item, or do you want more choice? And if you want more choice, maybe e-commerce is the way to do it. And there may be value to be had there. So you've got to identify opportunities where e-commerce is a naturally more profitable way to do business, as opposed to you're up against a very efficient supply chain, you know, and you know, it's a high cost of customer acquisition, it's high logistics cost. You know, the truth is that there is value in distributed inventories. At the end of the day, I can call up my local store and get it delivered to my house in 20 minutes if I want something which it has, which on an e-commerce, even if it's 10% cheaper, which I'm not sure the costs are 10% lower, I may have a challenge.
And this is something that I wanted, Amit, your perspective as well. I mean, if you look at the way local brick and mortar retailers in India are looking at the e-commerce opportunity, many of them are confident that it won't go beyond 10% of the overall market. Now, we may disagree, but the Future Group, Shopper Stop, many of them reckon that they can make the transition to omnichannel retail. So I just wanted to understand from the Amazon perspective, how does that impact the way that you're thinking about your physical storefronts? What is the future of omnichannel retail? Because this is a question that's come in on Facebook from one of our users, Vinay Varma. He wants to know what's the way ahead on omnichannel retail for India. Your comments?
So I don't really have a viewpoint because I don't really think about it as online, offline or omnichannel. I think at the end of the day, we recognize that customers will only shop with us until the very moment they get a better experience elsewhere. Whether that's offline, online, no, doesn't matter. So I think, you could easily have a fabulous experience offered by an omnichannel retailer. You could have a fabulous experience offered by an offline retailer. You could have a fabulous experience offered by an online retailer. I think customers are smart. Internet improves transparency and they will make the right choice. We need to make sure that we are providing a great customer experience. I think on the context that we were talking about, I'll give you an example. Everyday essentials is a category where the ASP problem even further stresses you and looks for innovation. I mean, the kind of change that we saw in trying to experiment with a pantry model, where customers had to be nudged to buy a certain kinds of things together and inventory placement, made that is something very exciting for us. I don't claim to have solved any of this, and I'm saying it will take us a lot of invention over many years, and we have the patience to do that. But what I'm trying to say is, it would at the end of the day matter how great an experience somebody provides and how they can invent around all the headwinds and constraints and take advantage of the tailwinds to make it a very sustainable, scalable model. Because at very large scales, you get a lot of efficiencies, but you also get hit by a lot of these constraints that we're talking about.
Right. So if you look at the fragmented nature of the supply chain, something that I think we've been discussing a little while ago, what sort of challenges did that pose for Amazon and how did you kind of respond to the nature of the supply chain in India?
No, I think it's a great opportunity. When I look at India, it kind of makes me feel that, you are trying to build every single layer on top of which you can have a great customer experience sit. So there is a lot of this investment that at least we are focusing on is, in each of these fundamental building blocks, whether it's logistics, supply chain, payments and so on, so that a great customer experience can sit on top of it. A lot of the manufacturers out there that are also entrepreneurs, they can use either our Seller Flex or our Fulfillment Amazon, which also, by the way, is an India first innovation, allowing our sellers to convert their location into a Amazon FC fulfillment center just by using a software. And very quickly they start connecting with customers and they save a lot of inefficiencies in trying to have that item distributed in a limited shelf space, and they pass that savings as value to customers. So I think the fragmentation and the diversity in India, because the customer tastes and preferences are so different parts of it, in my opinion, creates a whole new opportunity. It requires a lot of invention, creates a whole new opportunity. Another example is, we have been seeing a lot of good positive traction in just in our business-to-business, where we sell products to businesses. And businesses appreciate that we are organizing the supply chain for them. So we have, we've been doing it for the last 1.5 years in Bangalore, and we have a pretty deep penetration of just small businesses. You have these small stores to lawyers to baby care centers and all that buy their products from us, and every week they buy and it's profitable and it does well. So it's kind of, I think it presents a whole different opportunity that may not have existed if supply chain was completely organized in India.
One of the other issues that I wanted Harish you to come in, which is the center of gravity of where the market should lie, because a lot of the focus of e-commerce has been around the English speaking audience, looking at the top urban centers, but don't you believe that the real opportunity perhaps is to look beyond the English speaking audience and look at the tier 3, tier 4 markets? I know there are logistics challenges, but help us kind of walk us through what your perspective would be on how to.
Yeah, I think there are two things. I think language and video I think Indian consumers, who have not been the first adopters in the first 70 million, who are not English speaking, I think there's a massive opportunity to educate them, create more discoverability for the product, help them make choices. I think what's not happening today is that there's not too much help available when you want to choose between product lines or brands. And that all is possible through using video, using language, and really making it much more enriching and a full experience for a consumer who's probably buying online for the first time. It creates trust, helps them choose. See, everybody in India is now aspiring to have the best. I think that's one thing that's changed over the last 10 years is that aspiration is now democratic. I mean, there is no need for a person in a smaller city to not want to wear the same clothes or buy the same phone or have the same set of choices that a person in a town does. So I think the moment we use the tools, you'll find that there is a, see, India's, it's not as if the people in the smaller towns can't afford as much as the bigger towns can. So I don't think that's the challenge. The challenge is, can you talk to them in their language? Can you inspire them to buy? And what are the tools you use? And video is fantastic. Everybody, as you see how broadband is rolling out with Reliance Jio and stuff like that, as data costs go down, video will become a great way for them to show and tell and show and buy versus stuff and private labels. Frankly, I think there's India is a brand starved market. Again, kind of consumerism that's grown in the country. We don't have enough brands that keep pace with that. Private labels and own label brands offer both the opportunity to create market segments plus huge profitability because you can then just cut through the whole chain of costs and make money while selling these. So I think these are some of the things that have to be done to bring in the next layer of consumers in and actually inspire them to buy. All of them want to buy their new phones, new fridges, new air conditioners. And those markets are growing. If you look at the air conditioner market, massive growth over the last 2 years. I don't know how much online picked it up. But to make money from those consumers, you will probably have to find a way of delivering the air conditioner in a small town in India. And there will be money to be made there. Maybe bundle in some services. There are several obstacles for them to make the first move online. We'll have to find a way to bundle things and make it happen.
Amit, on that, I just wanted to bring you in. Harish was making the point about having very few brands across practically every product category. So is there, to your mind, scope for you to look at partnering and aligning with local brands and turning them into powerful private label businesses? And if so, how do you make it attractive for some of these smaller brands to come onto your platform? What's the support that they really need to become perhaps more relevant and have a sustainable business on your platform?
Yeah, sure. I think on just the first point, just as a data point, when we had talked about our October month, for example, we took a snapshot of the October month and asked ourselves, what kind of penetration was there, shopper penetration and seller penetration? And what we found was that 97% of India's serviceable PIN codes had placed at least one order on Amazon.in. So I get extremely excited by that kind of a number, which leads me to believe that I don't think so it's an urban phenomena. I don't think so it's a English customer-only phenomena. However, you do want to make it convenient for customers no matter what language they speak, no matter where they are, and you will require innovation. So, one of the things that we have, for example, is what we call as Project Rodan, which allows a local service center, whether it is a Aadhaar center or a financial services center, to essentially provide assistance to the customer to shop, and the customer can pay the local center, we deliver the product there. The local centers take so much pride that they do the customer service, they do the installation, they do the services part of it, and the whole thing works pretty well. So. It's an innovation which at scale could be very needle mover. On your point about brands, we launched Launchpad that allows brands to come on the Amazon platform, not just sell on India, but globally. We have a lot of Indian private labels on that platform. A lot of Indian brands are selling on Amazon today and selling are online only brands. Whether it's, I was on the plane that other day and this guy was sitting next to me. He said, "Are you from Amazon? I sell my tea box. It's a tea brand on Amazon." And he showed me his tea boxes on Amazon. He said, "I'm so excited." And he gave me his financials. And I can tell you that there was enough inefficiency to be sorted out in that so that both he can make money, Amazon can make money, and customers can access tea that otherwise would never have been possible without online commerce. So I think there's enough to keep us motivated, to keep inventing, but it's early days. And I agree, there's a lot of opportunity for Indian brands to become national brands, and why national brands become global brands.
Right. Sanjeev, I just wanted you to kind of perhaps address this whole issue of getting alignment with supply networks in India. When you're trying to do that online, some of the challenges that we found is that sometimes there is no proper service ethic, and aligning those suppliers becomes quite a challenge. We've seen what's going on with even Uber and Ola, right, where drivers are kind of militating. Is this a unique India phenomenon to your mind? And if so, what's going on?
Well, this is a phenomenon of a market where if there isn't adequate enforcement of the Consumer Protection Acts, you will find this kind of conduct. And really, it's up to the platform to ensure that customers are not unhappy with the services and products being provided there. And if they are, there is redressal. And beyond the point, there is also action taken against those suppliers by the platform. And ultimately, it's about the platform maintaining its integrity and its reputation. And I think any sensible e-commerce player will be conscious of that and will take adequate steps.
Right. Right.
No, and just stepping in here, if you look at Sanjeev's own business, I mean, how he navigated the challenge, I'm sure he started with hybrid business, having people, then going online fully. I think each company in the e-commerce space will have to find its own model. There is no one set formula that we need to be online only in every category. The kind of bundle of services, the kind of how you deploy manpower, what you use it for. As you've seen, a success story in Naukri that beat every company from everywhere in the world. So equally, I think the issue is not, is there a set formula that you need to apply, or is there a way you need to figure out how to use the available resources like what Amit was talking about and play around with the constraints?
Sure. So we'll quickly move on to the last segment, which is really a little bit of crystal ball gazing. We'll like each of the panelists to just kind of think, share their perspective of what the future will look like over the next 5 years. And I'll obviously focus, given the fact that we're talking about technology and enabled commerce, we can't but talk about some of the new disruptive technologies, whether it's IoT or sensors or machine learning or AI, that are dramatically reshaping the user experience. And I'd like each of you, maybe starting with Amit, to do a little bit of crystal ball gazing on how the world of shopping could look like in the over the next 2 to 3 years, or maybe 5 years. What are some of the challenges or problems that technology will need to address? Not just technology for technology's sake, but it must make a difference to the shopping experience. Amit, any thoughts from you?
Well, I think that experience is already changing and coming to the fore. I mean, if you're tracking some of the Amazon inventions out there, a dash button, for example, that allows the customer to simply press the button and get their products replenished in a few hours, to Alexa, which provides a conversational interface to fulfill your daily needs. I mean, you could just order milk. So I've ran out of milk and the milk could come to you, to Amazon's Prime Air, which delivers things in 30 minutes, to the Amazon Go store, which uses machine learning and visual technology to sort of play around with how you could create a very different shopping experience. I think there are a lot of innovations that are already happening. I think India will find its own way, what is right in the Indian ecosystem. But as computing becomes accessible, as what you can use, the ground reality data that you have access to becomes a lot, you can theoretically create a lot of interesting experiences by the machine learning through the process. Machine learning is a big contributor to even the small things on Amazon, the personalization that you see on Amazon.in. You don't have to guess. It works. It works because there's a ground reality, ground truth that the machine takes into account and delivers the most targeted result for a customer. Works much better than any human can do. So I think technology will play a very important role as you scale, as you deal with very large scales. But you'll have to find the right application for a customer problem and in the right scenario. I mean, some innovations may be right for a geography doesn't mean that they're right for every geography.
Okay, so if you were to kind of, since you have a global basket to dip into, what are the big problems that loom large for from an Indian perspective which need to be solved over the next 5 years?
Well, I think the, forget the global basket, I think in, just in India, I think one really structural big innovation that is just India first that's happening for India is this whole digitization of payments. I mean, I'm so excited to see, there are very few countries in the world that would take such rapid experiments to figure out how the whole India stack, Aadhaar-based payments, there's so much happening in that space. That I think a lot might change, and India might be a reference example for how digital payments could happen in the future. So I'm very excited by what's happening in that space. I think in terms of just trying to look at logistics, you will use a lot of machine learning to figure out the best way to get the product to the customer, reduce abuse, reduce your costs. Your ability to just target people to the right kind of payment experiences, you could use machine learning in many different ways so that they get the right payment experience at the right point in time. Personalization, trying to understand how customers in different parts of the country's shop will allow you to place the right selection for the right customer in the right place. I think all of these will have both a customer impact, that their experience gets better, and would reduce costs, which otherwise you would have to guess a lot in terms of a supply chain and how you deal with it. So I think automation in India can actually allow you to invent some of these solutions around the constraints we've been talking about.
Right. Sanjeev, I'd like to bring you in. Amit spoke about the whole Aadhaar India stack ecosystem. And at Founding Fuel, we're also very, very excited about what's going on there, because this is probably one of the largest open source models that you can kind of find anywhere else in the world. It's a very ambitious initiative. How do you see this playing out, and what impact will that have on both our entrepreneurial ecosystem as well as on the growth of e-commerce in the country?
India is a kind of country and market and society where most things coexist, right? So while you will have sports cars, you will also have bullock carts on the same highway. I think there will be online. I think many people will survive. Now, probably the rate of growth of the Indian economy, 7%, 8%, or whatever, will ensure that everybody survives at least in the medium term. Within the e-commerce industry, there will be some morphing, some adaptation, some consolidation, some success, some failure. But I don't see, this rapid shakeout and, people going out of business, very, very quickly, or, people are fearing. I think, people will find a way out.
Right. Harish, I wanted to you to come in. And you've been kind of watching the potential entry of some of the big Chinese players very closely. Yeah. And they've had, one would argue, some natural affinity for the Indian market, given their ability to deal with mobile-first customers. What sort of changes will their entry really herald over the next few years? What's your prognosis?
As I said, one of the challenges is that the market is in a sense shallow, and the returns are not available for capital. So I think the one big difference is the kind of balance sheets that will play in the market. You need to be having, in a sense, a much longer run capital base, in a sense, some form of permanent capital to play in the market. These players will bring in new technologies. I think the next 5 years are going to be really about, as far as the players go, of using their technology and the data they have on consumers to really focus on execution and differentiation. I think one is to get the execution right and bring down your cost structures, like Amit was talking about, but also differentiation. I at some point, all these players will have to decide where they play, what kind of services they offer, what is their exact consumer proposition. One player can't do everything. So I don't think there is, this market is going to be a winner takes all in that sense so quickly. Each of these brands now, and they're large national brands, probably, if you put them on a table, they'll be occupying the top spaces. And in Indians' mind, these have become such large, massive brands on the back of the spends they've done. Now, each of these brands will have to find a way to use their existence and figure out a niche or a differentiating strategy. And to the consumer side, I think they'll have to come up and figure out whether they need to use technology to bundle services, to give great price offers, or to actually allow more discoverability. For example, there will be a site which will sell fashion more, or do fashion, just an example, which will be able to sell to a more fashionable consumer versus selling utility apparel. So I think some of these decisions will play themselves out, and the entry of the Chinese players will actually accelerate it, because their focus also will be to find a way to create some differentiating offering versus just everybody fighting at the center of the market. I mean, that I think will be the way the next 5 years will play out.
And what sort of opportunities does that kind of hold up for Indian entrepreneurs in the startup ecosystem? Any thoughts?
I don't think this is a way to look at the market, Indian entrepreneurs or non-Indian entrepreneurs. I think everybody is clever enough, technology is available. Everybody knows, one of the wonderful things about the internet is that you can always see in a few days what another company has done. And it's not too difficult to reverse engineer it. So I don't know if there is any innovation that Amazon is going to hide in the market. So as long as our entrepreneurs are clever enough to follow in step, to innovate and lead the market in certain spaces and not confuse the license to invent for license to invest, which is what has happened. I think we will have a lot of winners here. They've built wonderful brands. They've had to take a hit, but that's par for the course in the business.
Right. Amit, I know you've been very comfortable remaining focused on your organic growth model in India. But when you look around at the startup ecosystem in India, are there specific opportunities that seem relevant for you from a M&A perspective? Especially things that reflect local nuances better for you? Is there a tuck-in kind of acquisition opportunity possible?
Well, I think, frankly, we are so busy just with our core focus on the customer that, and the organic approach has played out so well we are still on course where, at the same time, we are always looking for missionaries. A big part of what we look out is for, is there a missionary, company led by a missionary who is bringing something uniquely differentiated for our customer experience that attaches to a flywheel in a meaningful way. And we have made some investments. Bank Bazaar is an example that has some unique things that they're doing with the whole payment rationalization of the Aadhaar stack and so on. And they are very long-term focused missionary founders that over a period of time that we see synergies with Amazon. So I don't have anything to speculate right now, but we are very excited by the organic strategy that we have pursued. And at the same time, we continue to look for missionaries that fit well with our flywheel.
When you say missionaries, any examples from other markets in the world which suggest?
If you look at Amazon's investments and acquisitions, our IMDb is an Amazon company, and it was started before Amazon, and the founder is still around. That's what you get excited about. You have Audible, a great service that allows people to hear books, is a very unique experience. And again, that company and that founding team is still around. These are people who are excited by purposes that last many, many years, even decades. And we are excited by such people who are very focused on the customer experience and a very long-term outlook.
Right. Sanjeev, finally, any perspective on the new kinds of opportunities that will come up over the next 3 to 5 years which would present opportunities for startups in India to look at?
So, it's very hard to predict, and we don't even try. And we don't do things top down. We rather look at what's bubbling up by just meeting entrepreneurs, and we invest in companies. So we keep meeting entrepreneurs. So every week we get 8 or 10 business plans and we meet entrepreneurs and we figure things out. But I do think there's one emerging area where opportunities could be created, where you are helping existing offline businesses go digital. Right? I'm waiting for that app to catch fire and go viral, which helps the Chota Kirana store deal with his current customers and service them better and help them communicate to him and keep his business sticky. I think that's an opportunity waiting to happen. Now, I could be wrong. Maybe that'll fail. But I'm just saying there is an area of opportunity in helping existing offline small businesses go digital.
That's right. I thought Amazon was working on a plan of that kind, Amit, in Bangalore.
Well, we have Amazon Now, yes, which is our two-hour delivery app, which is now in four cities, that actually ties up with shops in your locality and makes it accessible for you. And we bring in our technology in their store and our logistics capability to essentially enable them. And that's doing pretty well. I mean, we are excited by the initial response. And that purely works on the inventory that's deployed around your locality in a fixed radius.
You've been a little bearish on hyperlocal.
So I think one of the, you know, I think the big change that's going to come is when entrepreneurs in India start thinking how to leverage existing infrastructure. It's, you know, it's not as if an Indian household is running their lives, you know, only waiting for e-commerce to come in. They're buying things are being delivered to them. So I think the interesting ideas that will come is when a low cost idea. See, several small suppliers are using WhatsApp very well to run their business. Now, how does one come up with a very low cost, simple solution that's simple for the customer, simple for the supplier to use? So, or equally, some people have now started experimenting using the milkman who comes every day. How can he deliver something else? So I think one of the challenges is that we have to start looking at the business as there is no need to start from base zero and say, okay, we're going to set up the infrastructure and have it deliver. The supply lines exist. You know, people are not going without milk and eggs or without their TVs or refrigerators. So all of these exist. How do you move it to digital? How do you put a layer on it which allows the strength of the internet to play out, as Sanjeev was talking about, is where the real innovation needs to happen. And when you add into this whole mix the entire Aadhaar and the trust layer that's coming up, you have massive opportunity coming up today, that suddenly a country that had very low trust as an offline or even online scenario, I suddenly will have a very high trust environment where transactions can be tracked, people can be traced, fraud will go down. So when you look at this, you are sitting on a massive opportunity if we start looking at the bottom of the market as to exactly how is an existing chain working and how to bring that chain up, add payments into it, add some service levels and a trust quotient to it, and enable that to work. So I think the big opportunity is there in us thinking, as I talked about it, as a Nirma moment we need to find a low cost mechanism to digitize the existing chains in the market.
That's a very interesting note to, I think, wrap up this conversation, the Nirma moment, or our WhatsApp moment, as it were. I think what we've heard has been fascinating. And thank you. I'd like to thank all the three panelists for offering, I think, a very hard-nosed, realistic, and very pragmatic view of what the opportunities look like. We've not been, I think, we haven't heard things that are built on hype. I think what all of you have spoken about is to remain grounded, look at what is already there, and try and see if there is a digital layer that can be kind of built on top of it instead of building from scratch. We've also heard, I think, what the power of technology really can do. And we've got some sneak peek in what the future could look like, and we couldn't have asked for more. Thank you so much, really, Amit, Sanjeev, and Harish.
Thank you.
For spending time today, and I'm sure we'll continue this conversation on the future of e-commerce on Founding Fuel going forward. Thank you again.
Thank you.